إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسانٍ إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, whether here with us on site or virtually, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We chose the subject tonight, Know Your Lord, Ma'rifatillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let me begin with a statement which was made by Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, a renowned scholar, who said, "Man 'arafa Allah bi asma'ihi wa sifatihi wa af'alihi ahabbahu la mahala." Again, "Man 'arafa Allah بأسمائه وصفاته وأفعاله أحبه لا محالة." Whosoever gets to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his names and attributes and actions, his heart will be compelled to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تقع المحبة في القلب بسبب المعرفة. The love which we develop in our hearts towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be found, will be felt because of this knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very unfortunate, ya ikhwa, many Muslims who come to this world and they actually worship Allah. Yani they pray, they actually perform certain acts of worship, but their knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to the minimum. There is a general knowledge, there is no question about it, but the level which can help improve their ibadah, their worship and their conviction is not there. We know from different hadith that different narrations that there is a connection between the knowledge which leads to loving Allah and the quality of the acts of worship. Take for example hadith Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, hadith al-Rahd fi Sahih al-Imam Muslim. In a nutshell, three individuals came to ask about the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam worships Allah. يسألون عن عبادة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. How does he worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imagine these three individuals, they felt like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not doing enough. I don't want to go into the hadith because this is by itself a subject here. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam condemned that. He didn't like that. He actually took the pulpit and he addressed the entire ummah. But here is what I'm looking for in his statement. He said, "La ana a'lamukum billahi wa ashaddukum lahu khashya." See the connection here? You see, you're going to do things that is not my sunnah because you're pretending that you know Allah better than me. I'm the most knowledgeable of who Allah is and I'm the most fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm not going to do the things that you're planning to do. Shahid from the hadith, the point of reference from the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam connected between the love of Allah, the knowledge of Allah, the fear of Allah, and the quality of the worship and being balanced as well. والآية إخوة في سورة فاطر إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. Indeed, the people who have the khashya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most. Ibn Kathir said, أي أعلمهم بأسماء الله وصفاته. Those who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his names and attributes. فالعلم بالله subhanahu wa ta'ala is a key to enjoy Islam. You know, because the scholars divided the religion of Islam into two things, into two halves. شوف العلم بالله والعمل لله. That you know who you worship and you worship him the way that he wants you to worship him. Imagine, that's the entire religion. That's the entire, هذا هو التوحيد وهذه الشريعة. خلاص, the religion is over. When you lack the first, there will be a defect in the second, unfortunately. This is what a lot of Muslims do not pay attention to. وتعجب يا إخوة, there are more than 30 commands in the Quran to know Allah. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Know who Allah is. No, there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولك أن تتخيل, look at this verse at the very end of Surah Al-Talaq. الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created seven layers of heaven. And likewise, by the way, there are seven layers of earth. وَمِنَ الْأَرْضِ مِثْلَهُنَّ يَتَنَزَّلُ الْأَمْرُ بَيْنَهُنَّ. The commands of Allah goes up and down. Allah administer His creation. Look at this. ذَلِكَ لِتَعْلَمُوا. In order for you to know, أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. Imagine the entire creation for you to know that Allah can manage this creation with the least of detail, the amount of detail. And وانت تعجب, if you look at the life of some of the like the ants, like the bees, how Allah structures the life in a way that is, Allah is the one who does all of that. All of this. Also, إخوة, كثير من العلماء, there is the last page in chapter Al-Hashr. I don't recall what number is the chapter, but Surah Al-Hashr. One of the سبح لله ما في السماوات. Look at this. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر الآية. ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم. Do not be like those who forgot who Allah is, and this led them to do what? To forget what? Who you are. Why sometimes you find a human who's walking on earth like a god with arrogance? Because who forgot? He forgot who Allah. ولذلك سورة الحشر, it ends with what? With how many names of Allah? وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام. You see the connection here between look at the people of Ad. أَمَّا عَادٌ. The people of Ad, they were given a huge, they were giants, 40 feet. يعني we read in some of the Athar, this is how big they are. أَمَّا عَادٌ فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَقَالُوا بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَقَالُوا مَنْ أَشَدُّ مِنَّا قُوَّةٌ. As for Ad, they were so arrogant, the people of Ad. Those are a nation. التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد. They came up with a civilization that never been brought into this world before. they walk in earth and they said, who's stronger than us? Look how Allah, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ قُوَّةً. So they forgot Allah. Now they ended up thinking what? فالإنسان وذلك يا إخوة, one of the things that really gets you when you happen to be in between, you know, roads and you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated for us this beautiful salah, اللي هي الاستخارة. Huh? That you want to marry, for example, and you don't know whether this, you know, this is the right spouse for you or not. So you pray istikhara. طيب. Reflect upon dua al-istikhara. Allahumma inni astakhiruka bi'ilmik wa astakhdiruka biqudratik wa as'aluka min fadlika al-azim. Look at this. Fa'innaka taqdiru wa la aqdir wa ta'lamu wa la a'lam. Oh Allah, I want you to guide me. Because you can and I can. Because you know and I'm not. You see that? When you forget who Allah is, you're going to think that you are the most knowledgeable. ولكن يقول من عرف الله بالغنى عرف نفسه بالفقر ومن عرف الله بالقوة عرف نفسه بالضعف. If you know that Allah is the most knowledgeable, you will never think that you're knowledgeable. You're always what? وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. It's a key. It's a key. Now we come to the question, how can we know Allah? How can we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I mean, let's be practical here. And you know, I was told that I will be addressing a lot of youth today. So hopefully, maybe online we have, mashallah, I have a lot of youth in front of me. I mean, all of you are youth. But, you know, especially our youth, this subject is a key to our youth. What is the best way to know about someone? You tell me. The senses. What is the senses? Seeing, hearing, that's the best way, right? To know you is to see you. Now the question is, can we see Allah in this world to know about Him? We're done with that. No. Look, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made that statement in Sahih Imam Muslim, and he made it in a context, a very interesting context. You know what he said? اعلموا أنكم لن ترون ربكم حتى تموتوا. Rest assured, be informed, be assertive about this, that you will never be able to see Allah until what? You die. When did the Prophet make that statement? Let's, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let's give that statement a context while he's warning us against the Antichrist. Now I want to ask you, because I want people to think here. I just don't want you to sit out there and look at me. What is the relevance between that statement and the Antichrist? What is the relationship? The Antichrist is going to claim that he is God. He's going to say, I'm God, worship me. Right away, this is in itself refutes his claim. If you're God, I shouldn't be able to see you. If you're truly a God, the God, the Ilah, with the attributes, with the names, I shouldn't be able to see you. Because the Prophet told me that you cannot see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. And subhanAllah, ikhwa, we have an experiment of a messenger, Nabiullah Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recorded that experience in the Quran in a chapter called Al-A'raf. Huh? That Musa alayhi salatu wasalam actually requested to see Allah. الآيات ولما جاء موسى لميقاتنا وكلمه ربه قال رب أرني أنظر إليك. When Musa عليه الصلاة والسلام came to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, came to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, oh Allah, can you make me see you? That's exactly the translation here of the verses in Surah Al-A'raf. Allah said, قَالَ لَن تَرَانِي. You cannot. But you wanna try? وَلَكِنُ انظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ فَإِنِ اسْتَقَرَّ مَكَانَهُ فَسَوْفَ تَرَانِي. We're gonna do an experiment here. You see that mountain here, and we're talking about the Ikhwa. I have been to Sinai myself. The mountains there are huge, huge. Allah said to him, I'm gonna do tajalli upon this mountain. فَلَمَّا تَجَلَّ رَبُّهُ لِلْجَبَلِ. What happened to the mountain? جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا. The mountain crumbled, went down to dust. وَخَرَّ مُوسَى صَعِقًا. And Musa fainted. How did the Prophet explain تَجَلَّ? The word تَجَلَّ, the verb تَجَلَّ. ما هو التَجَلِّي هنا؟ يعني التَجَلِّي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, الحديث في مسند أحمد وسند حسن, حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه, that Allah سبحانه وتعالى lifted the veil and he did like this, قدر أنملة, like this. Imagine that. ما هو, what is between us and Allah? What is between us and Allah? حجاب. في حديث أخرجه الإمام مسلم also, حديث أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه قال قام فينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم بخمس كلمات. One day the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم stood up and he delivered five meaningful words, five meaningful statements. كلمات here does not mean literally كلمة. كلمة is anything that is meaningful. Like he can call my lecture tonight كلمة. He given a كلمة because something that is meaningful. Look what he said. Number one, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنَامُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not sleep. وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَنَامُ. And it is not befitting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to sleep. يَخْفِضُ الْقِسْطَ وَيَرْفَعُ. He lowers people, he elevates people. يُرْفَعُ إِلَيْهِ عَمَلُ اللَّيْلِ قَبْلَ عَمَلِ النَّهَارِ. This is three. وَعَمَلُ النَّهَارِ قَبْلَ عَمَلُ اللَّيْلِ. So this is four. What is the fifth one, which is our point of reference? حِجَابُهُ النُّورِ. The veil between us and Allah is made out of light. لَوْ كَشَفَهُ. If this veil is lifted, لَأَحْرَقَتْ سُبُحَاتُ وَجْهِهِ مَنْ تَهَى إِلَيْهِ بَصَرُهُ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. Everything will burn. The fact that this veil is between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is out of the mercy of Allah, because if we would burn, we cannot. Ya ikhwa, you cannot comprehend the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through these eyes. You can't. لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار وهو اللطيف الخبير. You have to settle that we cannot see Allah in this world. There is a lot of debate, unnecessary in my opinion, because regarding the night of al-Mi'raj, whether the Prophet saw Allah or not, right? There is that debate. Muslims say, did the Prophet see Allah the night of ascension when he ascended up to the heavens? Abu Dharr fi Sahih Muslim asked him this question, هل رأيت ربك ليلة المعراج? Did you look at your Lord the night of al-Mi'raj? Look how the Prophet qala, he said what? Nurun anna ara, light. How I'm gonna, you can't see. I want you to try this, and I think you can do it here in San Diego, because in Denver is a little bit difficult. We get a lot of clouds. But when the sun is clear, there is no cloud, and it's midday, and the sun in the middle of the horizon. Go and look at the sun for a minute. Can you stand looking at the sun like you can't? And this is a creation. What about Allah? The light, you can't. I think the point is made here, is crystal, that we cannot what? See Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. You're asking me to know Allah and all these commands. I said a minute ago that there are over 30 commands in the Quran to know about Allah. And now I cannot see Allah. So how I'm supposed to know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You see, Islam, ya ikhwa, the top of the line of intellectual, of reasoning. You see, subhanAllah, look at the Christian faith, for example. And this is just for the sake of comparison. Look at the Trinity. Convince me that 1 + 1 + 1 equals 1. That's what they want to say. Father, Son, Holy Ghost is one thing. We're talking about three entities. How can they be one? Sometimes the best thing they tell you that look at the egg. You know, that egg thing always comes up. It has white and it has what? Yellow, and it has the skin. And still, you're not. Are you really convinced about that? Subhanallah, ikhwa, Islam tells you, use your intellect. Now, you cannot see Allah, but now utilize your intellect. How? Look around you and look at yourself and ask yourself who created, that's all. Who brought this into existence? Who created the mountains? Who created the trees? Who created the heaven? The earth? You will find these verses in the Quran over and over again. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَوْقَهُمْ كَيْفَ بَنَيْنَاهَا وَزَيَّنَّاهَا وَمَا لَهَا مِنْ فُرُوجٍ. Have they not looked at the heaven, how it is beautifully raised up without pillars? Look at that building where we're sitting. How many pillars are out there to raise the ceiling up? Look at the heaven. It has no pillars to raise it. And you're never concerned that it's going to fall down unless on the day of, it's the day of judgment. But Allah always asks you to what? To look and ask this question. Who created? Who created you? The most growing religion right now on the face of this earth, I'm sorry to shock you and tell you, is not Islam. It's actually atheism. No religion. Why? Because the education system across the globe is tuned to produce atheists. A lot of us send our children to the public school system thinking that they are learning Tawheed there. No, they are not learning Tawheed there. And then we become shocked that my son, my daughter is no longer following Islam. They are actually announcing in their social media platform, whatever they use, Instagram or Facebook, that they are atheists. They don't believe in a God. Why? Because of the education system. Imagine you send your child to for 12 years in a place they separate God from the system. Isn't that what America is based on? The separation between what? Remove God from the equation. You can be happy without Allah. That's what they tell your kids. You can be perfect without, don't bring Allah, don't talk about it. All right. And your child keeps reading these. You know, alhamdulillah, my kid goes to an Islamic school, but still, you know, the school has to be accredited, so you have to use the textbook. You know, the accreditation, you have to use the same textbook. But what we try to do, we try to Islamize, we try to, but one day my daughter is telling me, Dad, the genes define the color, the ethnic, the tongue of the child. I looked at it and said, the genes do that, huh? Not Allah, right? The genes do that. But that's what she studied in the textbook. Energy creates itself. Energy creates. That's a line, right? A common textbook. La. It's you see, you Allah, ولذلك يا إخوة سبحان الله, something that really amazes me personally, when you read the Quranic scripture, you will find so much emphasis on the fact that Allah is the creator. Allah is the source of life. Allah is the one who can benefit you. Allah is the one who may permit harm to fall upon you for a wisdom. Now that that's why I'm amazed, because at the time of the revelation, there was no need for that. The Arabs, at the time of the Prophet, they never denied that, by the way. The pagan Arabs, they never denied that. They never denied Allah is the creator. They never denied that. وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ They will say Allah. وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ العزيز العليم في الآيات الأخرى. Allah is the one who created. But what they ended up doing, he said, okay, we believe all of that, but we cannot go Allah to Allah straight. We have to go through what? Intermediaries. واسطة. ما نعبدهم إلا ليقربونا إلى الله. Lat wal Uzza, but they take us what? Closer to Allah. That's all. But they never denied that. But subhanAllah, you see, the Quran is a text for the until the day of judgment. is now, when you read the Quran now, someone who went to the public school system for 12 years, coming out thinking that there are so many powers, independent powers, who act on their own in this world, now the Quran restores that. Allah khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of everything. And Allah is the one who makes everything works. فالشاهد or the point I'm trying to يعني emphasize here in this particular issue is, you're supposed to look around you. ما هو, there is one verse in Surah Al-Tur which refute any atheist intellectually. We have not even gone into the text yet. You know, if you're talking to an atheist, you're still talking intellectually. You know what the verse is? What the verse is? أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. That's the question that you, if you meet any atheist, just asking this question. Were you created out of nothing, or did you create yourself? What is the answer to those two? What is the answer? No, no. Otherwise, he's crazy. You tell me this pair of glasses came here out of nowhere. Would you accept that intellectually? No one will. Unless you believe in magic or something. That's something sorcery. That's something else. But so were you created out of nothing, or did you create yourself? Now, what is the most common thing? I mean, not even in the public school system, actually, the media. Like right now, I'm sure if you go home because of this tiny rain that you guys had in San Diego, you should come to Colorado and see how the weather there. They're going to tell you what? Mother Nature. You hear Mother Nature there? Mother Nature. Yeah. It's Mother Nature. What is Mother Nature? Mother Nature brought the rain? Did Mother Nature bring the rain? That's again, ya ikhwa, these are terms which resonate. الألفاظ هذه بتبني معاني قوالب. The more you hear it, by the way, the more you hear it, the more it becomes what? Built in. It becomes built in. You know, I don't know if do you guys have Geico here in the East West Coast? Huh? What about this? 15 minutes can save you 15% or more in car insurance. What about that? You're familiar, right? Why? Because it repeat. Mother Nature. There was this guy, we read this story, that he was holding a dung of a camel, ba'ra. عارف الba'ra بتاعت الجمل, huh? A dung of a camel. It looks like a date. if you look at it. He's holding it in his hand for people passing by. Oh, nice date. Okay. Someone's, oh man, that must be delicious date. You know what he did at the end? They convinced him it's a date. في مقولة كده يقول لك إيه؟ ما تكرر تقرر. When you keep repeating the message all the time, huh? تكرر. ولذلك يا إخوة سبحان الله, every Muslim now we wake up in the morning, the society where we live in order to keep us subdued and subservient to them, they must make sure that the three things are absent. Three elements are absent. I call them a triangle. I call them a triangle in the book. A triangle. God, Day of Judgment, religion. Cancel those out completely. We want to hear about those. Right now in America, by the way, if you talk about God to someone, if you talk about religion to somebody, you're invading their privacy. Because religion became what? A personal thing. That's my personal thing. You know, I don't want to talk about my personal life. No, God, don't talk about God. Don't talk about God. Okay, religion? Oh, you're a free man. And now they associate, they equate religion with what? Being backward. Okay. Oh, you follow that thing, man, that tells you what to do, how to go to the bathroom, how to dress? Yeah, religion. Day of Judgment, no Day of Judgment. So they are keen on making you forget those three. God, Allah, there is no Day of Judgment, there is no test. Don't worry about it. Can you imagine you go to college and then your professor tells you, guys, I canceled the finals this year. Imagine what kind of school is that would be? That would be a very, you're going to go party every night. There is no finals. There is no Day of Judgment. You're not going to stand in front of Allah and answer the things about the things that you've done. There is no test. And you know what, guys? There is no curriculum. There is no religion. There is no curriculum. Don't worry about it. There is no do and don't. You're free. You're free. Wa'alaikum subhanallah. Look how Islam works. What is the chapter that you have to repeat at least 17 times every day? Which chapter? Fatiha. 17 times at least a day, every day. Two Fajr, I'm talking about the mandatory. Two Fajr, four Dhuhr, four Asr, how many are those? 10, three Maghrib, 13, four Isha, 17 times. If you add another 12, which is if you want a house in Jannah, if you want to build a house in Jannah, huh? Be protected from hell. If you do the 12 rak'ahs voluntary, that's what? 29. But if you do one witr, that is what? Only one. You could do three, of course, if you're a Hanafi, huh? Right? Three, right? But one, 30 rak'ah. 30 times every day, you're reminding yourself of those three. Allah, religion, Day of Judgment. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الرحمن الرحيم. You want me to forget this? I'm going to remember it every day. شوف how Islam is tuned to treat, to resurrect that Allah is the creator. Allah is the creator. So when you look again, if you want to know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look around you. Who created you? Who created the universe? Who made it in such an order? شوف لي والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون. Look at the system, the orbit around you. Perfect. Now, who made that? You're going to tell me that they made themselves? Come on, get out of here. Oh, they came out of nothing? Oh, Mother Nature? Well, let's discuss. What do you mean by Mother Nature? You mean God? Mother Nature is God? Is that what you mean? Well, why not call it God? Oh, we're not supposed to talk about God. Remember, we live in a secular community. We don't want to mention God. Let's call it Mother Nature. La, la, la. Let's call it God. Let's agree to call it God. He's the one who did that. Now, when you do that, when you look and ponder, use your senses to look. Use your intellect to establish that there must be a creator. Also, the other element that you must establish is the created cannot be equal to the creator. So there must be a creator. And the creator has to be what? Much better than what he created. أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقُ كَمَنْ لَا يَخْلُقُ في سورة النحل. Is the one who creates equals to the one who does not create? وذلك احنا, we as Muslims, we worship who? Who do we worship? We worship the creator, not the created. Look at any religion in the face of this earth. What they worship? They worship created. Jesus, wasn't Jesus created? What do you mean by created? Created that he had a birthday. He had a beginning. Allah has no what? Allah is the first without what? Beginning. Also created meaning that he will have an end. He will die. One of the things that we believe about Jesus, brothers and sisters in Islam, that he will descend again towards the end of life to help the believers, and he will die and he will be buried like any other human. He will end his life. For created meaning, he has a beginning and he has what? An end. Allah doesn't have. Allah is khayrul warithin, is the best of those who inherit. Why? Because he never dies. Allah never dies. Fashahid is, when you conclude that the one who created everything around you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is not equal to what he created. Now, how should I learn about Allah? It's time now to wrap your intellect into a little hanky, put it in your bucket, and go where? Go to the revelation. Because we agreed that you didn't see Allah, right? There is nothing equal to Allah. Nothing is similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst his creation. So there is no way you can use your intellect to figure out who Allah is. Who Allah is. Now you have to go to the revelation. You have to go to the names and the attributes of Allah mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And subhanallah, ikhwah, you will find out that third of the Quran talks about the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a matter of fact, the most precious, the greatest Quran, the one that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the greatest verse in the Quran? ما هي أعظم آية في القرآن؟ آية الكرسي. What is آية الكرسي is about? الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده. There is one chapter, two lines in the Mus'haf equals third of the Quran. What chapter? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. Finally, the greatest chapter in the Quran, الحمد لله رب العالمين. Nothing like it was revealed in the Torah, in the Gospel. When you look at the Quran, you will find the most precious, in the sense of, if we compare, Quran is the one that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But unfortunately, ikhwah, this is an area where shaitan comes and plays big games with our minds. You see, Shaitan is very active in this area. He makes us think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that is not suitable. وهذا أمر يعني this is a matter that actually used to be in existence even during the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Imagine a group of companions came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and said, يا رسول الله, we think of Allah in a way that we cannot say it. Look how Shaitan comes here. That he makes you think and visualize Allah in a way that what? That you cannot say it. You know what the Prophet said to those companions? This is faith. هذا, this is how he said. ذاك صريح الإيمان. This is a sign of the purity of faith. But what is the Prophet ﷺ is referring to here? Is referring to you not talking about it. Because you shouldn't be saying that about Allah. Shouldn't say. Imagine now we have Muslims who speak about Allah like they are talking about their friends. We became like Christian and Jews in this area. Christian and Jews, they talk about Allah, they run their mouth about Allah in a way that they turned Allah into... I remember this, Ikhwal, debate I had with a Christian priest. It's available online, I think. Where we were talking about the divinity of Jesus. There is one verse in the Quran that really demo. You know what demo is, right? Demolish the subject once and for all. The verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah. What does it say? ما المسيح ابن مريم إلا رسول قد خلت من قبله الرسل وأمه صديقة كان يأكلان الطعام. You wanna say that? المسيح is a messenger who came in a chain of messengers. And his mother is a truthful woman. They used to do what? Eat food. Now when you're debating with you know, and you know, with non-Muslims, and by the way, when you talk to non-Muslims, it's not good to have Muslims around. Because sometimes you may end up what? Using terms, using words. Sometimes you, you know, you try. So I said to the priest, I was debating, was I said, what do you do after you eat? What do you need to do? You know? Obvious. You know, he came back to me and his rebuttal. And he said something blasphemous. I mean, I hate to say it, but I just want to convey it to you. So that's the intention behind it. You know what he said? He said, Imam Karim has an issue with God taking a leak. Imagine you say that about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I came back to him and I said, you know what? This is the difference between Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. That you guys run your mouth about God with no evidence. But for me to talk about Allah, I must have an evidence. You see, that's something that many Muslims do not know. That you cannot describe Allah, say something about Allah that has no evidence. I can't say Allah does that if I don't have an evidence. I cannot say Allah doesn't do this without an evidence. Many Muslims don't pay attention to that, by the way, that in nafi. Also, you need to have an evidence. To negate something, to say Allah doesn't do this, you must have an evidence. You can't say, like, can I say Allah doesn't die? Can I say that or no? Sure. Can I? Why? وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. That's the evidence. But I cannot say it if without this. Without that evidence, I cannot say it. Because by the way, you may end up insulting somebody just by negating things. What do you think about that? Guys, Milad doesn't go to the nightclub. He doesn't smoke weed. I'm insulting him, really, right? Why would you say that about him? You're getting that. Likewise, like, why you cannot say Allah does that? You have to have it. Likewise. The point here I'm trying to say that many Muslims don't comprehend the rules of how to learn the names and the attributes of Allah. Add to this, you know, the Ummah went astray. We have sects actually. amongst the 73 sects who went astray, Al-Jahmi, Al-Mu'tazili, all these are sects who went astray in what? In the area of what? In the area of the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Add to this, shaitan doesn't leave you alone. Imagine this hadith, hadith Abi Hurairah. Shaitan will come to one of you. The Prophet said that, by the way. Shaitan will come to one of you and he will say this: who created the heavens and the earth? Guess what? You know what? Shaitan is going to help you. Say Allah. Say Allah. Shaitan is going to do that. Then you're going to say Allah. Then who created you? Say Allah. You see, he's taking you. Who created Allah? The Prophet said that. That's not, I'm not saying that. This is a hadith. What should you do then? Many Muslims don't know. Say, Amantu billah, I believe in Allah. Get out of here. Allah is the first without what? A beginning. Don't come to me in this area. Intahi. Say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan. Many Muslims, brothers and sisters in Islam, unfortunately, when it comes to the subject of the names and the attributes of Allah, and how to learn them, how to acquire the knowledge, the way that the companions learned them and understood them and comprehended them. We never read that any of the companion had an issue with the names and the attributes of Allah, the way that many Muslims are doing it now. The only author that we really know is the man who came to Imam Malik and he asked him about what? Stawa ala al-arsh. We believe as Muslims, by the way, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne, above his creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not part of his creation in any form or shape. Ask an average Muslim now this question: where is Allah? What is the answer you're going to get? What is the answer you're going to get?
Everywhere.
That's the answer you're going to get. But whether it is correct, everywhere. What do you mean Allah is everywhere? That means Allah is part of his creation? A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. You know, that is the foundation of Christianity, that the divine God came into what? The human flesh. A'udhu billah. La. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the creation. Now, some people already have issue with that. Imagine the same question was presented to Imam Malik. What do you mean by istawa ala al-arsh? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne, above the creation. What do you mean by that? He said, al-istiwa'u ma'loom. If you speak Arabic, you know what istawa is ala al-arsh. You know what istawa al-arsh. Istawa'u ma'loom. Ala wa istaqar. In a way that suits his majesty. Al-Imanu bihi wajib. You must believe it because it's in the Quran. How many times? Seven times in the Quran, istawa ala al-arsh. You have to believe it. Al-Imanu bihi wajib. How did he do it? I don't know. Al-Kayfiyya, I don't know. How? I don't know. Should I know? Should I find out? No, you don't have to find out. Listen, Allah did not ask you to figure out how his attributes are, the nature and the reality of his attribute. Just believe it the way the language refer, the meaning refer, and leave it. Then at the end of the day, لا يعلم كيف الله إلا الله. Memorize that. The only one who knows how Allah is who? Allah. You can't reach that. So leave it alone and don't ask about it. والسؤال عنه بالدعاء. And asking about it is a better. الاستواء معلوم. الإيمان به واجب. الكيف مجهول. السؤال عنه what? Apply this to any of the attributes of Allah. I don't want to burden you here. There is a book that is coming out, inshallah, this weekend, called Know Your Lord. Inshallah. It will have very practical steps. Inshallah. Hopefully our brother, my editor, brother Jimmy, will finish it this weekend, and it should come out before the end of the year. Know Your Lord, it will have these rules in how to understand the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way the companions of the Prophet ﷺ understood them. I want to rest my case here. Jazakumullahu khayra. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Barakallahu fiik. Jazakumullahu khayra. Is it good with time?